I'm standing here now in the grounds of the Church of San Joaquin in Palo, Leyte. This is ground zero of the super typhoon Yolanda that took place here across Central Visayas on the 8th of November 2013. As a result of the devastation that followed the wake of Yolanda, the Cebu Province Extraordinary Provincial Council decided to establish a general mission to cover our parish in Tacloban City as well as 11 other parishes within the Archdiocese of Palo. Here on this ground, as you will see later, is a mass grave where 365 bodies were buried a few days after Yolanda. The devastation of Yolanda was not only in terms of the loss of property, but in the terms of loss of hundreds, if not thousands, of lives. Government statistics put this figure at 6,700, but many people here say the figure could at least double, if not triple. This video production is to share with you what this general mission was all about. We hope that by showing to you the footages that you would see in this production of the devastation across Tacloban City and the Archdiocese of Palo, you would have an idea as to the content and methodology of the general mission in a location that follows the devastation of a major calamity such as Yolanda.
This story began with the news broadcast throughout the Philippines in the days before November 8, 2014. A super typhoon codenamed Haiyan internationally and Yolanda locally was to hit Central Visayas Friday, November 8. It was expected to make a landfall in parts of Samar, Leyte, and other islands in the Visayas. There was even talk of a storm surge, except the people did not understand as yet what was a storm surge.
Kuha ito mula sa barko ng Coast Guard, muntik ng rumampa sa pier sa lakas ng storm surge. Kahit ang sasakyan na ito na nakapwesto na nga sa mataas na lugar, ay hindi pa rin nakaligtas sa storm surge.
Yung palagay ko, ito na yung storm surge natin.
Yolanda was indeed a super typhoon, lashing out the islands at 368 kilometers per hour, one of the strongest to ever hit the country. While the strong winds blew houses away, toppled down coconut and other trees, and caused a lot of devastation, it was the storm surge, namely, the sea waters rising to as high as 20 feet, moving inland, and flooding entire villages that caused the death of thousands who perished in this tragedy. In San Jose alone, where the airport is located, thousands were swept by the tidal waters as dead bodies reached the city proper a few kilometers away. In Animbor and Ruiz, located near the pier and the main market, thousands also died as cargo boats smashed both concrete houses and shanties built along the coastline. The government has downplayed the statistics of the disaster, claiming that only 6,300 died and close to 2,000 missing. The agency tasked to monitor the number of casualties stopped counting at this number. But ordinary folks claim that the number of casualties and missing would double, if not triple. Their statistics as to houses totally or partially damaged is also underplayed. The Philippine Shelter Cluster estimated that in Tacloban City alone, more than 5,000 houses were damaged, with almost more than 2,000 washed out.
Pero may dati kang gudang pagbidoy, malaga na kamong ato habukin.
Bidang, o di na mismo, ang kutay palang tubig, nakada pala kalsada, taga din palang tubig na mo, dini. Umagto na kami.
Pero bangin, ang inan na naman to.
Oo, makusog na. Bisan nga yun, kuwam pala, dispiras pala, di ang kapi.
Ay, yun
na, nagpalaging ko ng trapal.
There is a Redemptorist community in Tacloban along Real Street. The Redemptorist compound has a church, a convent, and a social hall. In November 2013, there were 5 Redemptorists assigned to this community, with Father Edwin Bacalto, CSSR, as director. Miraculously, except for the smashed door and a few broken windows, the church was spared, so also the convent and the social hall. More than 3,000 survivors evacuated to this place of safety and comfort. And the community members, along with the parish collaborators, assisted the survivors who were traumatized by this horrific disaster. Redemptorist communities across the country, and later throughout the world, mobilized resources to support our community and the evacuees. So also kind-hearted associates, friends, and even anonymous donors. Immediately, the Cebu and Manila units provided material and moral support to the survivors in Tacloban City, Leyte, Samar, North Cebu, Bantayan, and Panay Islands. But Cebu's extraordinary council, with its members just coming out of a missiological conversation attended by Father Superior General and a few members of the General Council, felt that this was not enough and more was needed to be done. From out of a discussion on this agenda, a decision was made to set up a general mission intended for the people of our parish. However, if the Archdiocese of Palo was interested, then we could include a few more parishes. In mid-December, a few of the council members met with the Tacloban community to plan out this mission. Then they went to visit Archbishop Jando to offer this mission. He was overjoyed at this prospect, saying that this mission was an answer to his prayers. Personnel were then assigned to coordinate the general mission with Father Jerry Matriano, Pio Macabenta, and Brother Carl Gaspar. Communications were sent to all Redemptorist communities, inviting confreres, foremans, and lay missionaries to volunteer for this mission. As preparation, a one-week training was conducted in Cebu among the core members of the team to evolve a mission methodology appropriate and relevant in a post-disaster setting. And the first set of volunteers arrived in Tacloban City on January 24 and immediately found time for a quick ocular survey of the parish. Two days later, Father Jimmy Villanueva officiated the entry mass, attended by hundreds of parishioners. And within the next few days, we were around visiting the survivors in evacuation centers, tents, temporary shelters, or homes that were slowly being repaired. There we began to hear the people's stories of struggle and survival. Stories were heartbreaking as they narrated the extreme difficulties that they encountered while they were hit by the strong winds and the flood waters. While crying, they told us who among their family members, relatives, neighbors, and friends perished in the deluge. They spoke of their guilt at not having saved their loved ones, and of the voices they heard at night, and of dreams where they were haunted by the dead and the missing. We moved to the coastal areas outside our parish. These were in Anibong and Rawis, as badly hit as San Jose, and the coastal villages of our parish. Here, one immediately sees the impact of the storm surge, with close to 10 cargo boats stranded on the ground. Yolanda pushed them to the shore, and in the process, the boat smashed concrete houses and shanties, killing hundreds of those who refused to evacuate. Because of the vast area we were to cover and the limited time and personnel of this mission, we divided ourselves into sub-teams of 5 to 7 members each. Each sub-team planned their activities after the ocular survey, meeting with church and civil leaders, and consulting the people as to the activities that could be conducted. Visiting the families was the way we were present to them, as we listened to their horrifying stories, helping them to interpret the meaning of this. Before leaving their homes, in the presence of the members of the family, we had rituals to bless them and their houses. Haunted by the memory of the dead bodies that littered the streets, and voices heard in the dead of night. The people ask us to bless the dead spots or the places where the bodies were placed and where they stayed in the sun for a number of days before they were recovered by the Department of Health and the Fire Department for identification and burial in the mass graves. With small and big groups, our team members had a prayer ritual that respected the people's indigenous belief system, but also deepened the theological meaning of the communion of the dead. Psychosocial engagement for stress debriefing and trauma healing of children and youth took place in a variety of circumstances and locations. Some sessions were in schools, others in makeshift tents, a few in small groups, and others involving almost 100 kids. Therapy was our major approach, but interspersed with games, storytelling, and other types of social interaction among them. They shared their stories drawn on paper, either in small groups or to the entire big group. Oftentimes, the narrative was accompanied by tears. We also brought together young people who lost a loved one as part of the follow-up process. In all this, feeding was always integral in this particular type of activity. At the heart of our mission. We had masses everywhere, inside churches and chapels, under a tent, in a public space, where people come together to dance or play ball, by the seaside, and places where chapels used to stand, but were washed out by the floods. We provided space for the people to share their narratives and prayers. We prayed for the dead, and use all kinds of symbols for the rituals. And the priest's homilies dealt with the themes that are included in the books of Jeremiah and the Lamentations, but also on the essence of Christian hope. Wednesdays were occasions for a novena to our Mother of Perpetual Health, followed by a liturgical celebration. The icon was present everywhere when we gathered, so also the statues that survived the deluge and which were brought by the people for a blessing of the priests. As we moved into the season of Lent, we had stations of the cross, and in places like Barangay 69, we went around the community by the damaged mangrove forest, walking down the highway, climbing the hill, where the people run at the height of the flood, and then walking down towards the coastal areas, where we joined the other groups that had walked by the seashore. In all these occasions, children were with us. There are thousands of them in the mission areas, and they are always the first to be around when an activity started. They were a delight to us, and even help in the various tasks. But they were also a pain in the neck when they got very restless. Our hearts reached out to them, fearful that it may take a while for their trauma to heal, as well as afraid that their parents would not be able to provide them with a brighter future. But in their joy and mirth, their innocence and openness to the prospects of life, we resonate with the hope that is in their young hearts. There are enormous problems faced by the people. There were days we found ourselves helpless in responding to these urgent needs. The state's Department of Environment and Natural Resources has pushed for the implementation of the Presidential Decree of 1067, or the Water Code of the Philippines, making the 40.0-meter easement from the shoreline as a no-build zone. Its implementation would displace thousands of people living in the coastal areas, many of whom rely on fishing as livelihood. As the government has yet no plan for their relocation and the prospect of permanent housing, the people are very insecure as to where they could find a place to rebuild a house. Meanwhile, the housing problem remains acute. In order to provide a public sphere where the government staff and the people can dialogue on what can be done, we set up public fora in both our church and in the communities as our way of being able to help find a solution to these problems. Summing up our 14-week experiences of the General Mission, we ask ourselves, what were the gospel messages that we were able to convey to the survivors of Yolanda? Perhaps our mere presence among them, as we immersed in their homes and communities, we were able to manifest God's sense of compassion for them, instead of reinforcing the notion of a punitive God who punished them for their sins. We have helped strengthen their belief that through it all, God never abandoned them, that God did protect them from further harm, that God had gifted them with a second life, and that this gift brought along the notion of a mission for them, that it was for them to reflect on what this mission was all about. and that possibly this mission involves a conversion of self towards becoming more compassionate for others, to serve their families better, and their communities even more, and especially those in need. That as tragedies do and will still take place, and that if we are co-creators of God, we do have a responsibility to be engaged in activities that will not destroy the environment. This has been one reason for the occurrence of climate-related calamities. But instead, God demands of us to protect Mother Nature and to make sure that we work towards climate justice.
And perhaps one final message that the missionaries involved in this general mission here in Tacloban and in the rest of the Archdiocese of Palo is a biblical one. We were able to convey to the survivors of Yolanda that despite their grief, despite their pain, suffering, that continued to haunt them until today, there is life beyond the impact of the disaster. And here at Ground Zero, in the grounds of San Joaquin Church in Palo, where more than 360 bodies were buried just a few days after Yolanda, the metaphor is alive. More than 3 months after, here the cemetery remains as a mass grave. And during the typhoon, as the storm surge reached this part, rice seeds flew and were drawn by the waters to these grounds. And now, here they grow in this field. And the biblical notion of unless a grain falls and dies, there will be no eternal life, is truly present in this, the ground zero of Yolanda.
Unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it abides alone, it abides alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit, bears much fruit. But if it dies, it bears much fruit.